Everybody, thank you for joining us this week. We're going to talk about two models, the RAT and the PICRAT model. We'll start with the RAT model first, and the PICRAT model elaborates on the RAT model. What in the what is the RAT model? You know, RAT sounds like the animal, but it's more interesting than that, I would say. So the first R in RAT stands for replaces. In other words, the teachers use technology to replace previous practice. And so this can serve as a layer of convenience or cosmetic improvement, but ultimately doesn't fundamentally change the nature of the lesson. So think about how smart boards are not ubiquitous, but smart boards are pretty present in a lot of classrooms today, and they replace the regular whiteboard. And so it's not something that's transforming the classroom, but it is using a new technology to do something that they did before. And hopefully it makes it better. Digital post-it notes are an example of replacing paper post-it notes. They serve the exact same function, but it's a digital copy, a digital way of doing something that you did before. Now, when we move to the next phase, we're looking at amplifying. So teachers can use technology to make their practices or their lessons more effective and to improve the learning outcomes. And so in this way, technology can add elements to the lessons that are not easily achieved with traditional classroom methods. So think about how you might have students work in OneDrive or on Word online, and then you can comment on the student's papers, especially if you're teaching a thesis or dissertation student, that you can use track changes and you can use digital means for communicating with each other on the document itself, as opposed to back and forth that you might have within an office or a classroom. And so it's a digital way to leave feedback and to correspond with the students. And so that can amplify, you know, digital documents can amplify in that aspect. And the last one, so we're looking at RAT. T stands for transforms. And so teachers using technology to really transform their practice. You know, it results in, if you were to take away the technology, then you would actually take away the practice, or the absence of the technology would make it impossible to present the content. And so one way that technology is transforming classroom, especially in online classes, would be using Zoom or Skype or Microsoft Teams for having class meetings online, something that you wouldn't be able to do without that technology if it's an online class and you can't meet in a physical classroom. So this web conferencing technology is really transforming online teaching and learning. Another example might be using Google Earth to explore various aspects of your community, or having students create virtual reality interactions with a 360 camera. You know, without the technology, you wouldn't be able to do that. And so it really transforms the classroom. And so let's look at this RAT model framework for integrating tech into the classroom. One way that I can present this, you can graduate from one level to the next, is if you think about walking. Walking is, that would be like the original lesson that you have in your classroom. And so walking is a means for transportation, but then eventually we develop this new form of transportation, the covered wagon, to replace walking with a family transportation that transformed it in a way, or at least it changed it. And then we have the cars. You know, a car is a way that you can transport your family even faster and easier than the covered wagon, and much better than walking in many cases. And then we have our airplanes, technology used to completely transform transportation in a way that was previously inconceivable. If I were to pick up today and say, I'm going to take my family to Italy right now, it would be possible. I could maybe walk to a boat, which would take me to Italy. And after many months and a lot of seasickness, I could get there. But planes have made it so that we can be in one location. You can traverse the entire continental US within 5 hours, and then you can come back. And that wouldn't have been possible in a covered wagon. That would have taken months. And so let's look at these components of the RAT model. So first, we're going to look at replace. So we have replace, amplify, and transform. And so replacing, as an example of this, I took a picture this morning of my desk and my post-it notes. I use a lot of post-it notes. It doesn't always look like this. I kind of gathered them and, you know, scattered them on there for the sake of this picture. But I also use digital post-it notes on our Microsoft computers. We have access to the Microsoft post-it note feature, or whatever they call it, but it's essentially the same thing. And so, you know, it might be a slightly better in that I can delete and I can, you know, cross out, add pictures to it, and I can make it bold or whatever. But essentially, I'm just replacing. I'm doing the same thing that I did before using a new technology. It's the same end, the same instructional end. It's just a digital way to do it. So it's like a proxy, a stand-in or a surrogate. Another example would be having a PDF copy of your journal article or book chapter instead of a paper copy. You know, it changes the appearance, but not necessarily the lesson or the content itself. And it doesn't really affect teaching or learning practices and behaviors if you have printouts of the journal article on your phone versus in paper in your hands. But it still can be important because it can increase the access. For example, a dog can't eat your homework if your homework is digital. And so it doesn't really improve learning, but it is it's a good approach nonetheless. So let's look at amplification, some examples of amplification. Now, amplification improves the efficiency of your task and it introduces new functions to the original task. I was browsing for pictures online and I came across this one. I really liked this picture. And so the platform they're using there is called Kahoot. And this is definitely an activity that the teacher could engage the students in using pen and paper just in the classroom. But they are interacting with tablets and they're playing a game and it's computerized. They have a time limit and a leaderboard and, you know, they can skip answers. And so it makes it more engaging and it amplifies. It does what the teacher could do, but it does it better. You know, it's not transforming teaching and learning necessarily, but it is augmenting it. It's having the students do new tasks that they wouldn't be able to do otherwise. You might not be playing Kahoot, but you might do a poll everywhere or a Microsoft form or some other kind of technology that would be similar. So now let's look at this transformation. How do you transform the classroom? And an example that I want to share is a class that I'm teaching. And what we have on the screen here, this is an example of a discussion board. This is probably, you've seen something just like this, and it's essentially, it asks a prompt. It says, describe two examples of, you know, whatever it is, according to the articles, and have an initial post by Wednesday, respond to two other students throughout the week, you know, yada, yada. There's a rubric and all that. That's a typical discussion, and I don't want to say that that's ineffective, but when you're doing that every single week for every single class that you always teach, read this assignment and answer this discussion prompt and, you know, call that an assessment, maybe there's a way that we can transform that. And so what I did is I reworded the assignment, still keeping in mind the curriculum alignment, that we have certain outcomes that we want to measure, certain achievements and tasks that we want students to do. But I introduced a new activity into this discussion thread. I'm telling the students, I want you to go out, instead of talking about customer satisfaction, I want you to go out to a store and take pictures. Every student that I've had has access to a camera, a digital camera of some sort, pretty much. And so create a scrapbook using this platform called Padlet and scrapbook your experiences. Take pictures, write reflections, and then I give them some prompts down there. You know, these are the things that we're learning from the readings this week. We're talking about physical layout and traffic patterns and aspects of customer service and the overall shopping experience. And so I want them to create a visual representation of the store and share their reflections with the students that way. Not just text on a page, but it would be a lot more colorful. So this is an example of what a Padlet might look like. And so you have links to websites, pictures that you take, reflections, and then in the discussion post after they share this, they can write, respond to the prompts that way. So it makes it more engaging. For me as a professor, it's transformed this experience because I get to see stores that maybe I'm not familiar with. Now I do go to Trader Joe's, but there might be other stores in other places that are regionally specific or boutiques. They can go to big box stores like Target or Ulta, or they can go to these boutiques or international markets. It's a way that has transformed this assignment because without this technology, the technology is layered, meaning you have digital photos and videos using your phone, you have access to the internet, and you have this Padlet platform and embedding the Padlet platform into the discussion thread. And so if I didn't have that technology, I wouldn't be able to do this assignment in that way. And so in that way, it's transformative. So that's the RAT model. We're talking about replacing technology with other things, amplifying it, and then transforming the classroom. What in the what is the PICRAT model then? So we're going to introduce new elements to replace, amplify, and transform. And those elements are the creative, interactive, and passive, or rather passive, interactive, and creative elements on there. And so With the passive learners down at the bottom there, the students are observers, they're bystanders in their learning, which isn't always bad. This webinar is an example of passive learning. You're watching me or listening to me and seeing my slides while you sit there and you're absorbing the content that I'm sharing with you. And that's okay for this kind of activity. The interactive approach means that students engage in material and interactive in it, and so they're active learners. For the creative, it means the students create materials for themselves, which is the apex of student engagement, really. So students often learn more profoundly when they create something using the content of the class. So if we combine the RAT model with this new PIC framework, we can create a matrix of different ways that technology can influence teaching and learning. In the top row here, I have the C's for creative. And so there's replacement creative, there's amplifying creative, and then there's transformative creative. And then for amplifying, you can have passive, interactive, or creative ways to amplify. And so it's a good matrix. As we're looking at this, let's use video for an example. So suppose I am in my class and I create a video. It could be an overview for a module. It could be an announcement video that I create for my students or screencast of some sort, and I have my students watch it. And so where would that fall in this matrix? We're looking at passive learners. It's essentially replacing a live lecture. And so if I record my lecture and put it online or an announcement, that would be the same as if we were meeting face-to-face in a classroom and I'm standing in front of the students providing a lecture or discussion or giving them feedback. Only this way it's online. I'm replacing an online video with my presence. And in this case, I'm just having the students watch whatever I'm saying. So they're passive and it's a replacement, which is fine. But if I wanted to move up to amplifying and interactive, then I might use my example that I used earlier of a Zoom classroom. We are replacing the physical classroom with something digital, and the students are interacting in that I can ask them questions. It's not one way. They're not passive learners. They can be interactive. They can be giving feedback. They can be giving their thoughts and opinions. I can even have them share and present and take turns presenting. Now, if I wanted to go to the upper echelon and have them create something and really transform it, then I might have them create their own videos, just like how I create a screencast. In this case, they're creating something. And that shot right there, that's the Camtasia platform to have them do that. And it would be a creative, transformative approach. And I've done that a lot in my class. I've had students create instructional videos and either share it with me or share it with the class. There's no better way to express that you're learning content, because we can't really measure learning, but we can have the students create content. Creating content and explaining content, they're able to demonstrate indirectly that they have learned the content. And so we have this framework here. We're looking at passive, interactive, creative, replacing technology or amplifying or transforming the classroom through technology. And I want to mention that we have a 3x3 matrix here. None of the squares on this grid are a bad way to teach. I don't think so anyway. Sometimes it's good for learners to just be passive and to listen. So this bottom row right here, it can be good for them to just be passive listeners. If you're in this webinar right now, then you're a passive learner. If you're watching this or watching the recording at a later date, then you're also passive, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. And I'll also say that if students are always engaging in creative and transformative activities, they may become overwhelmed or exhausted. I don't want you to see this matrix and say, every one of my activities better be on this top row or in this top right corner, because that can just be overwhelming for students and you don't want them to experience burnout. Rather, a good teacher is always going to be evaluating their practice and looking for ways that they can improve using this PICRAT model. And it may be that you want an even spread of things, or you might notice that a lot of my activities are in one quadrant or another. Let's spread that out. If they're all on the replace and creative, how can we get to more transformative practices? If they're all passive, how can we increase the interactivity or have the students create their own interactions? A good teacher will always be evaluating their practice, looking for ways to improve. And I want to mention another thing about technology. Technology, educational technology, is great. You might see something that looks spectacular. It has a shiny racing stripe, and it's something new, and it's something interesting. And you might think, I want to use that technology. That technology would be super great, and it would be awesome if I can use that in my class. But you don't want to go about EdTech in that approach. You don't want to see something and see, how can I retrofit my own lessons, my own activities, so that we can incorporate this technology? Instead, refer to this PICRAT model and really look at, where would this technology fit within the PICRAT model? One thing is you don't want to use new technology. Well, you can ask yourself this question. Do I want to use new technology to do something that I'm already doing? Is it going to be better than what I'm already doing? You know, if you're using a whiteboard for the same reason you would use an overhead projector, is one necessarily better than the other? Is the smart board going to change what I'm doing, or am I just going to write on it like I would a whiteboard, but use the digital thing? And so you want to ask yourself, and you want to use the PICRAT matrix to see if there's a way that you can use that technology to really transform your teaching and enhance your learning in the classroom. If it's passive and replace, how can we get that to interactive? How can we bump it up to something that's more creative? How can we move from replacing existing technology to amplifying or transforming the technology? If you want, you can have this so you can remember the PIC, print it out if you want to walk through a course, and you can put check marks as you're going through. Let me just read this for you. So essentially, these statements here in the green are students' relationship to tech is, and you fill in the blank with either P, I, or C. So students' relationship to the tech is interactive. Like if they're doing a Kahoot quiz or a Nearpod activity, maybe they're interacting with the content. If they're creating content, like you have them create a slide deck that they have to share with the class or create some flashcards, then you might say students' relationship to the tech is creative. And so you'd know that that falls on this top row here. At the bottom here, we have teachers' use of tech replaces, amplifies, or transforms traditional techniques. And so if I'm looking at a way that we can use Camtasia or Canvas Studio, and that previously we didn't use Canvas Studio, and I'm having students create screencasts for each other, then I might say teachers' use of technology transforms traditional techniques, because without Studio, they wouldn't be able to create their screencasts. Or if it's amplifies, then, you know, I'd fill in the blank with one of these elements down here. The relationship is going to be either passive, interactive, or creative, and then the use of the technology either replaces, amplifies, or transforms the techniques. And based on those two blanks, you would find your place on the matrix.
Happy teaching and learning!